Fathers of Baptism, Monsignor Thomas Weinzapfel, died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory.
Please join in our entrance in the missalette, number 308, for all the saints, number 308.
Thank you.
in life. Tom cherished the gospel of Christ. May Christ now greet him with these words of eternal life. Come, blessed of my Father. In baptism, Tom received the sign of the cross. May he now share in Christ's victory over sin and death. Dear friends, 2 weeks ago, we stood here and we celebrated with Monsignor Tom his 70th anniversary as a priest of Jesus Christ. It was a joyful occasion. He himself was so happy and so pleased that he called me the next day to tell me how much he had enjoyed his evening. Today we gather with a little sadness, but with the same profound sense of hope and joy that I am sure that I will wake up in the middle of the night tonight and hear Tom Weinzapfel tell me that I forgot to do something at this point.
From the book of Ecclesiastes. There is an appointed time for everything, and a time for every affair under the heavens. A time to give birth, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot the plant. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace, and a time to be far from embraces. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to cast away. a time to rend, and a time to sow. A time to be silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time of war, and a time of peace. What profit have workers from their toil? I have seen the busyness that God has given to mortals to be busied about. God has made everything appropriate to its time, but has put the timeless into their hearts so they cannot find out from beginning to end the work which God has done. The word of the Lord.
To you, O Lord, I lift my soul. To you, I lift my soul.
Well, I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. the word of the Lord.
Sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer and say, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say to them in reply, "Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did it for me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Wow. I think if Msgr were here, he would want to take up a collection. Maybe we should. Bishop Kevin Farrell, Abbot Peter Verhalen, Bishop-elect Greg Kelly, all my brother priests, deacons, family of Msgr. Tom Weinzapfel, and the parish family, St. Pius X of Msgr. Thomas Weinzapfel, and all of the flock that he ministered to in one way or another, so often, right here, by his very distinguishable voice. I think maybe he fell asleep during lots of homilies and He's certainly sleeping now. As Bishop Farrell said, December the 23rd, we celebrated his 70th anniversary, and many of us were here for that occasion, and it was a beautiful occasion. One of his parting words to us at the end of the Mass was that perhaps the next time that he said this quote, the next time that we all gather here together, I will be carried into this church. And really, just 2 weeks later, that's exactly what happened. My name is Father Henry Petter, and I'm the pastor of St. Anne in Capel. When I was 17, in 1963, I moved to this parish. Our family moved to this parish from the Weston Abbot area, closer to the Waco Hillsborough area. That's where we moved from, to come here, to become a member of this parish. I was already in the seminary at St. John's in San Antonio, the minor seminary. Same one that Tom Weinzapfel started in. And yet, Monsignor Weinzapfel claims me as one of his vocations. We argue about it from time to time, but there's no arguing with Monsignor Weinzapfel. And in a sense, he was right, because I was in the seminary then. I quit for 6 years in the midst of that seminary time, went 4 years into the Air Force, and then back, entered into the seminary again, and this time I was a member of this parish. So he is really true in many different ways. I used to remind him that when he was ordained, on the day of his ordination, I was in my mother's womb. I was in my mother's womb for 6 months already. And I thought maybe that I might have leapt in my mother's womb. And he was fine with that, because I turned 70 in April of next year. So, you know, maybe I can have a big group like this for my funeral if I can just live 30 plus more years to be 100 years old. Monsignor died on January 1. It is a time of year when we look back at our lives, and also we look forward in our lives. What a beautiful time to end up in a timeless sphere of heaven. But January 1 was also the celebration of the Mary, the Mother of God. And he fell on Christmas Day, and then his funeral now is on January the 6th, when many years we celebrated this as the Epiphany. And in many different ways, wasn't Monsignor Weinzapfel an Epiphany himself? And he built this church, which is also an Epiphany, because you can see it from far off, and it was a sign God's presence here in this place and in this area. And wasn't Monsignor Weinzapfel a sign of God's presence in the world? So it was appropriate for us to choose Ecclesiastes. There's a time, an appropriate time for everything. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to love. We have that beautiful sign in the back that says, "Love one another." It was the way that Monsignor lived. chose Timothy because he was poured out like a libation. And he told Father Michael Guadagnoli just before he went into surgery, I'm ready to go. He was ready to go, not because he thought he was sinless. He's a sinner just like all of the rest of us are. But he was ready to go because he knew he had a Savior. And that's what he preached when he stood before us so often. That we have a Savior. And that's what he believed. And that's why he could have hope in his heart just before that surgery, thinking that this may be the last moment of his life. And we chose Matthew. Honestly, I have to confess that we chose Matthew because of the sheep and the goats. But he was a generous man, especially when it came to feeding young people academically, whether in this school or whether in being so instrumental in beginning Bishop Lynch High School and the beautiful, beautiful things that he did for the families that entered into that this parish. He would feed his people. And yes, he used to ride his bicycle in the neighborhood, and he would use his nose to smell different. It was around dinner time, and so he would smell. He didn't have very good ears, but he had a good nose, and he could smell good food. And when he felt like this was a good place to stop, he'd knock on the door and invite himself to dinner. But it was a way that he became intimately involved with his flock. It was a way that he began to smell like his sheep, because he entered deeply into their relationship. He knew his sheep. And yes, he expected much from his sheep. Those who went to school, children who went to school here, he expected a tithe, and he expected service. Not one or the other, but both. And yet, he was very kind to those who perhaps couldn't give as much as others. He treated everyone, whether you had a whole lot of money or very little, with the same kind of respect and dignity. I know that because our family didn't have that much. And we found him in our home many times, eating our food, listening to my dad's accordion music, etc. He loved to travel, whether it was in planes, trains, automobiles, in his own plane. I had the dubious honor of riding one time in his plane. That was all it took. Because yes, as Bishop Farrell said so beautifully a couple of weeks ago, yes, we prayed a lot when we were in the plane. The only time I didn't pray in the plane is when he started pushing all kinds of buttons, and then he just laid back and went to sleep. Because the plane was on autopilot, and I knew we were safe for at least a little while. When he was on retreat with us priests, or wherever he might be, where he sat down with us and ate with us, he would ask very piercing questions to get us in dialogue with one another. He didn't mind sharing his opinions, and he had a lot of them. But he wanted to know what you thought also, and he would ask questions in many different ways that would end up being, you know, that he's trying to advise you, give you counsel. And he certainly did that with many of us priests. He did it with perhaps many of his parishioners. He certainly did it with the bishop. He really tried to tell the bishop how to run this diocese. I think he might be telling Jesus Christ right now. I have to congratulate Monsignor Raykumper now, because he's 92, so he is the oldest now. Many times he would, when he greeted Monsignor Weinzapfel, he would ask him, "How are you feeling?" Because Monsignor Raykumper is very used to being number two, you see. Now he's number one. And so congratulations. Just a couple of more things. He was 70 years a priest. So how many sacraments did he give to us? You can just take just a Eucharist by itself. And, you know, I'm looking at my almost 40 years as a priest, and I think I average out perhaps a little more than one a day. But let's be conservative and say Monsignor Weinzapfel celebrated a Mass a day, on the average. That would be, as my calculations, and he was always very good at math, 25,550 Masses. Then I forgot to put the leap years in. He lived through 17 leap years, so it's 25,567 Holy Masses that he celebrated. And even after he resigned from St. Pius in 96, he was at St. Michael's in Garland, he was at Sacred Heart in Berlin, and he was here at St. Pius X, many times with the Over 55 Club, and saying their masses. Someone the other day gave me a prayer written by Lacordaire about priests, and said, you know, you might want to use this for the ending of your homily. Well, I never liked that prayer. I didn't like the first two phrases especially, because it goes like this. To live in the midst of the world without wishing its pleasures? I don't think so. I think when Monsignor Weinzapfel was in the middle of a golf course, he loved it, and he took a lot of pleasure in beating somebody, winning at the end, collecting his money, begrudgingly giving when he lost. But I think he enjoyed flying in the air and watching the sunset. I know that was the time when I flew with him, and the sunset was absolutely beautiful. He took a lot of pleasure in that, so I really take issue with that first part. Without wishing its pleasures, he had all kinds of opportunities to enter into your lives and enjoy the fullness of life. And that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to enjoy life. And then the next phrase, to be a member of each family, yet belonging to none. I'm looking at his family right here. All of his family. And he didn't abandon you when he was ordained. He continued to enter deeply into your lives. And for those who have gone before us, Ensign Robert Weinzapfel and Father Joseph Weinzapfel, and his Agnes and Helman and Dora Jackson, who have gone before us, and they leave behind Juanita and Mary and Henry and many, nieces and nephews and grandnieces and nephews, etc. And his parish family. But so that's why I didn't really like that prayer, but the prayer that I like that I want to end with is Karl Rahner's prayer about priests, or quote about priests. The priest is not an angel sent from heaven. We're not canonizing Monsignor Weinzapfel right now. We're commending him to the Lord. We can work on the canonization later. Rahner goes on. He is a man chosen from among men, a member of the church, a Christian, remaining man and Christian. He begins to speak to you the word of God. This word is not his own, of his own. No, he comes to you because God has told him to proclaim the word. Perhaps he has not entirely understood it himself. Perhaps at times he adulterates it. But he believes, and despite his fears, he knows that he must communicate God's word to you. For must not someone say something about God, about eternal life, about forgiveness, majesty of grace in our sanctified being? Must not someone of us speak of sin, the judgment and mercy of God? So my friends, pray for him. Carry him so he might be able to sustain others by bringing to them the mystery of God's love revealed in Christ Jesus. He will live forever in our hearts and in our minds. And we will continue to love him. And he will continue to love us. Because love doesn't come to an end. Amen.
God the Almighty Father, raise Christ the Son from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
For Monsignor Weinzapfel, when baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, he may now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother Monsignor Weinzapfel, who served the church as a priest, he may be given a place in the liturgy of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our brother, Monsignor Weinzapfel, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints.
you may bring him to be nourished by their truth and reality as unveiled in heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
On behalf of Monsignor Weinzapfel's family, they are deeply touched and have been these last 2 weeks, and they want to express their sincere gratitude, their thankfulness, and also to offer their prayers with all of us here, all here in the community at St. Pius X. And especially we thank Bishop Farrell, the Abbot, and also the Bishop-elect, and all those who are here today. We are grateful for your presence, your prayers. We will have, in just a moment, we'll have the final portion of the funeral rites here, and then we will proceed to the burial at the priest circle there at Calvary Hill. And then afterwards, we'll come back to St. Pius for a reception. The reception will be in the parish hall. You're invited to all or any of those events. And again, we do appreciate your continued prayers for Monsignor Weinzapfel's family and also for the repose of his soul.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day, we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Oh, God, and angels.
mercies, we commend our brother, Monsignor Thomas Weinzapfel, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed on Tom in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to Tom and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We now take our brother to his place of rest.
Please join us in our closing hymn. In the Missalette, number 337, now thank we all our God, number 337.
Sword.
Exules filii.
in hac lacrimarum vale. Ea ergo advocata nostra, eos tuos misericordes oculos a nos converte. Ene Jesu, benedictum fructum ventris sui, nobis hostos.